Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome on this seventh Sunday of Easter, final Sunday of Easter. We'll hear a little bit more again about the new heaven and the new earth as we are reading. Sermon reading for today is the Revelation text. Some of you may have heard that there was a little excitement at the parsonage last night. Three fire trucks, an ambulance, and the police. We had some smoke damage. One of the sump pumps started melting and burning and filled the whole house with smoke. But my daughter and I and the cats are okay, and the house didn't start anything else on fire, just the sump pump, but it was stinky. We left the windows open all night. So if you hear about some excitement last night, now you know what happened. Stave off any rumors that might happen. So I'm very grateful to our police and our volunteer fire and EMS folks that were there and helped out. They used fans to air everything out, so it was livable last night. A couple announcements. VBS is coming up soon, June 23rd through the 27th. So if you haven't registered your children yet, please do so. And if you are available to help out with meals or leading the classes around or leading games or crafts, please let Katie know in the office, or you can contact St. John's directly. You can support St. John's Lutheran Home today. They're having a lunch served from 11 to 1 over at the Springfield Sportsman's Club, so you can support St. John's by attending that. I think they call it a trigger tournament, so you'll get to see some live action as well. And finally, we do have coffee talk this morning downstairs, which you're invited to as well. With that, I invite you to please rise as you are able as we begin our worship with the brief order for confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our entrance hymn is on page 158. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 of Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Savior is with you in eternal glory. Give us faith to trust that true to his promise, he is coming soon to take us to himself eternally in the kingdom without end. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we now enjoy some special music.
Thank you. Our first lesson comes to us today from Acts 1, verses 12 through 26. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and James, James of the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, together the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was numbered among us and was allowed to share in his ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness and falling headlong. He burst open in the middle and his bowels gushed out. He became known to all the residents of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their language Helicon, which is, that is, field of blood. Where it is written in the book of Psalm, 'Let his homestead become desolate, and let there be no one to live in it. Let another take his possession of overseers.' So that one of the men who have accompanied us during the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out of us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed to Joseph held Barbas, who also was known as Judas, Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in his ministry and an apostolic from which Judas returned, aside to go in his own place." And they cast the lots out for them, and a lot fell on Matthias, and he also added the 11 apostles. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 133, and we will read it responsibly. "How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes.
It is like the new Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord ordained his blessing to live forevermore." Our second lesson this morning comes to us from Revelation 22, verses 1 through 20. "And the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb to the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life, which its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the trees are for the healing of the nations. Nothing accursed me will be found there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it. And his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. And there will be no more night. They need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. And he said to me, 'These words are trustworthy and true. For the Lord, the God, and the spirits of the prophets, has sent his son, angel to show his servants what must soon be take place. I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of his book. I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed them to me. But he said to me, 'You must not do that. I am a fellow servant of you with you and comrades prophets, with which those who keep the words of his book worship God. And he said to me, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Let the evildoer still do evil, and let the filthy still do filthy, and the righteous do be still do right, and the holy be still holy. See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, so that they will have the right to see to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. Out are the dogs and sorcerers, the fornicators, the murderers and idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. See, I Jesus, who sent my angel to you with his testimony for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come, and let everyone who hears say, come. And let everyone who is thirsty, come. Let anyone who wishes to take the water of the light as a gift. I warn everyone who hears the word of the prophecy of this book, if anyone needs to them, God will add to the person the plagues described in this book. If anyone takes away from the words of the book of his prophecy, God will take them away that the persons share the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. And the one who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter. Jesus prayed, I ask not on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us. So that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I am them and you and me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me, where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you remember when we first hear about the tree of life in Scripture? Well, we have to go all the way back to Genesis. The second and third chapters refer to this tree of life, which was in the Garden of Eden. But as we remember, the tree of life was next to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which was forbidden Adam and Eve. But we know that they traded the relationship that they had with God. They traded his promise to give them everything that they needed, and they exchanged it for the fruit from the knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And everything changed in that moment. If you remember, they hid themselves. They were covered in shame. They then knew the difference between good and evil because they had done what they were not to do, and they felt guilt and shame. And they hid in the leaves until the Lord found them and clothed them. And then we read in Genesis that God says, "See, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil, and now he might reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." Well, what's so wrong with that, right? Eat and live forever? Well, you've probably experienced some anxiety in your life. Right now, I know that there are many farmers, especially, that are experiencing anxiety as they're not able to get their crops in. Things are behind. Things have been wet. And we know that this happens again and again, doesn't it, right? There's always these fears that people keep telling me it's a risk to be a farmer. And this week, I visited with a number of people who have lingering health problems that the doctors cannot get on top of. They just keep suffering through it, going on and on and on. Many of you here may know what that's like, to have an illness or an injury on your body that, or even aging, right, that just keeps lingering, holding on. And of course we know that the wages of sin is death. And this sickness, this aging, this anxiety, all of this is that threat of death upon our bodies. This is why Paul in Romans 7 calls it this body of death. Imagine being trapped forever in a body with no hope of ever being delivered from feeling the wages of sin, feeling this threat of death eternally, hurting, feeling uncertain for all of your life. So Paul describes this. He says, "I don't understand my own actions, or I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what's good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self." Of course, this is the new self created to trust in Christ alone. But he goes on to say, "But in my members, hands, feet, tongues, another law is at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members." He finishes, "Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death?" Any of you experience this? You keep doing the things that you don't want to do, and you don't do the things that you want to do. Those who are dieting might know what this is like, right? Those chocolatey things are there, or you can have your salad, right? Which one does your body want? Well, the chocolate, of course. So this battle now between the old and the new self, it continues within us until death. It's a battle between the old creature, the old self, that trusts in Christ alone, trusts that word, knows that deliverance is coming, and between the old creature that places its trust in, we place our trust in ourselves, in our works. We may trust the things of creation in place of God, such as trusting in doctors, right, and medicines, higher, more trusting than we do in God. And so, in God's mercy, to prevent us from being stuck in this body of death forever, at the east of the Garden of Eden, God placed cherubim and a sword that was flaming and turning to guard the way to the tree of life so that we would not have access to it. But here's the thing. It's always been God's plan to rescue us. To rescue us from ourselves, from this sin that is just a part of our human nature now because we've inherited it from Adam and Eve. And we know that this is God's plan and that it, John the Baptist made the announcement when God's plan hit its full stride and Jesus appeared on the scene, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Now, why is this important? Well, our reading tells us that here in the holy city, the New Jerusalem, when God takes us to himself, those who will be left outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the fornicators and the murderers and idolaters, all who love and practice falsehood. And what's the difference between those who are inside the holy city and those who are outside of the holy city? Do you know what it is? Jesus Christ. Faith in Jesus Christ is the only difference between the two groups, right? Do we still fear, love, and trust things above God? We do this, right? This makes us idolaters when we place our trust in anything or our love in anything above God. It makes us idolaters. It's only through faith in Jesus Christ, which comes from hearing the word, that we then are invited inside the gate for eternity, inside the holy city, the New Jerusalem that God is created. And Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God, referred to in our text, who has taken all of our sins upon himself. He claimed your sins and mine as his own, first in the waters of baptism. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, named himself dog, sorcerer, fornicator, murderer, idolater, in our place. He who knew no sin actually became sin for us, taking all of that upon himself. And so in the waters of baptism, we know that he's written his name on your forehead, as it states here in our reading, right? The cross in baptism marked on your forehead. The difference is that in heaven, in the New Jerusalem, you'll see it, right? You'll be marked. Who you belong to, you belong to Jesus Christ. And he's also marked this cross on our hearts. The cross of the Lamb who was slain, the Lamb who bore the sins of the world, the Lamb who bore your sins for you in your place. And he was forsaken of God, put outside the gate where our sins should put us, where he instead went for us in our place. The Lamb who washed your robe clean in his own precious blood, making you righteous in God's eyes. The Lamb who by his sacrifice opens to you the gates to the holy city, the New Jerusalem, allowing you to eat freely of this wondrous tree of life. 12 different fruits on one tree in its season. Amazing. And the leaves of that tree heal all afflictions. In the Lord's Supper today, you're going to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for your healing. As you received a taste of that the beautiful river of the water of life at your baptism, and you were invited to drink, you were invited to come, all of you who are thirsty, today you will receive a foretaste of the feast to come, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you also receive this great promise from Christ. He will not leave us here in this place with our suffering and our anxieties and our pain, but he promises, "Surely I am coming soon." Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Knowing that the Lord has promised to hear, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the church on earth may be one, united in doctrine, in witness, and at the table of the Lord, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the Lord may guard and protect his church, that she may be kept faithful in the face of temptation and persecution, and be made fruitful in the work she is to do in Christ's name. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may grow in the knowledge of God's word, and that we may be faithful teachers of that word to our children and to those not yet of the kingdom. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may enjoy favorable weather so that our farmers may plant their crops and receive a bountiful harvest to provide for the needs of all. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the nations may enjoy peace, goodwill, an end to terrorism, and freedom from oppression, and that our leaders may be faithful in their service, in the protection of all life, and in the pursuit of all that is just, fair, and good. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the sick may be healed, the suffering relieved, the grieving comforted, and the dying granted peace. Especially we pray for Lee Stern, Carol Meidel, Gary Buck, Tanya Hovland, Chuck Churchill, Mary Hollis Sternberg, and Alice Trebisch, that the Lord may grant his grace to all who have need, and that they may be strengthened in weakness, granted patience and trial, and given endurance for the race that is set before them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may joyfully bring the fruits of our labors and the tithes and offerings of a grateful faith to the Lord, and that the church may not lack for resources to accomplish God's purpose, nor the poor suffer need because of our indifference to their plight. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may remember the faithful who went before us and now rest from their labors, and that we may follow in faith where they have led, and at length be brought with them into his everlasting light and life, to see him face to face. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We commend these and all our prayers to you, O God. Come near to us with your saving help, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We will now receive our offering. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord, for he is the true Passover Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. And gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the beautiful prayer our Lord Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. You may be seated. The ushers will usher you forward. There is a gluten-free wafer available should you be in need of that. Please request it. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Receive now this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Our closing hymn is on page 170. We're going to sing verses 1, 4, 5, and 6, and it is Crown Him with Many Crowns.